Penguin Random House presents The Origin Story of India's States by Venkataraghavan Srinivasan. Read by Venkataraghavan Srinivasan. Introduction. I love looking at maps of India. Roadmaps allow me to dream about great cross-country adventures. Topographic maps highlight the textures of the land through the mountains' wrinkles and the river's meanderings. Satellite maps trace the coastline's undulations that give the country its distinctive shape. Maps show me the beauty of India. When I was a child at school, my absolute favorite map of India was the political map that clearly demarcated its states. India's states fascinated me with their various shapes and sizes. My favorite activity was coloring in the states neatly and meticulously with sketch pens. The stories of the states of India are also the story of India. The states of India are all-encompassing. They cover every inch of land and hold every single person that makes up India. Every person in India belongs to a state, lives and works in a state, has family and childhood memories in a state. States give every Indian a home and an identity. Every time a new state is created or an old one altered, India and Indians are remade, recreated, reborn. Every single Indian deserves to know the story of their state, their home, their identity. That's how this book was born. We know the origin story of India, but what are the origin stories of each of its states? 15th August 1947. It is tempting to view this date as the singular date on which India was formed. However, India was not formed all at once. There was no process of formation that was completed on 15th August 1947. In fact, if anything, this was the date when the first process of the formation of India began. On 15th August 1947, not only did the British Crown partition India on both its western and eastern sides, they also left behind an internal mess that threatened to destroy the country from within. For starters, the outgoing British administration handed over only about 60% of the country's land to the new Indian government. The remaining 40% of the country belonged to the rulers of 565 princely states. The British Empire had administered India with two systems running in parallel, a direct system in its provinces and a separate indirect system across the princely states. When British paramountcy lapsed on 15th August 1947, only the administration of the provinces transferred to the new Indian government. The ruler of every princely state was offered three options: join India, join Pakistan, or remain independent. This was a massive problem for the new Indian administrators. Each of these rulers, scattered across the land, had to be convinced individually and collectively to merge with the new Union of India. The States Ministry, headed by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and executed phenomenally by V.P. Menon, visited every ruler and secured their signature on a standstill agreement and an instrument of accession in record time. They reimagined the landscape of the country, merging and integrating princely states with each other and with neighboring provinces to create a complete coalesced whole. It was the first time India had been successfully integrated as one nation. At the same time, they recognized that these internal mergers were fluid and allowed for future reimaginings. On 26th January 1950, India adopted its constitution and became a union of states with 28 states. The Constitution mentioned each state by name as an integral part of this union and classified them into four categories based on administrative setup. The Constitution of India is an incredibly flexible document, but it is equally firm as well. New states may be admitted and established in the Union, but no state has the power to secede or leave the Union. For this reason, the chief architect of the Indian Constitution, Dr. Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar, described the Union of India as indestructible. The states themselves, however, were entirely destructible. A state could be split into multiple new states, or multiple states could be merged to form a new state, or portions of multiple states could be merged to form a new state. The areas of states could be increased or decreased. State boundaries could be redrawn. States could be renamed. Every state in India has been altered in the above manner, many of them more than once. After the initial amalgamation of the country in 1947-49, the next large-scale reorganization came in 1956 with the States Reorganization Act. This was triggered by the agitation for and the creation of Andhra State in 1953. The States Reorganization Commission considered the future of all the states of India with a balanced approach in the interest of our national unity. The Commission recommended doing away with the four-part classification of states and introducing a new category called Union Territories. The reorganization resulted in 14 states and 6 Union Territories. Starting from the 1960s, states began to be reorganized on an individual or cluster basis. Gujarat and Maharashtra separated in 1960. India integrated Portuguese territories in 1961 and French territories in 1963 as Union Territories. Nagaland was created in 1963. In 1966, in one move, the states of Punjab and Haryana were created in the north, along with the Union Territories of Chandigarh and Himachal Pradesh, which later gained statehood in 1971. In 1972, the Northeast and Assam were reorganized, which brought into existence the states of Manipur, Meghalaya, and Tripura, as well as the Union Territories of Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram. In 1975, India's international borders expanded to include Sikkim. 1987 saw the transformation of the Union Territories of Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, and Goa into states. In 2000, three states in Central and North India split into six: Uttar Pradesh and Uttarakhand, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, and Bihar and Jharkhand. In 2014, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana separated. In 2019, the Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh were created in place of the erstwhile state. The states of India are alive and fluid. They meet and dance and meld and flow with their neighbors. The stories of the states are the stories of its people and their homes. These stories are dramatic and emotional, filled with struggle and hope and despair and joy. Researching and writing this book was a profoundly moving and emotional experience for me. I discovered India through numerous published writings by multiple people, including researchers, academicians, and government officials, who studied and wrote on matters related to individual states. Through their works, I met historical figures and witnessed key events from across 75 years. I owe them my eternal gratitude and respect. This was the journey of a lifetime in a year when we all had to stay at home, and it allowed me to indulge in my childhood joy of coloring in the state's map of India all over again. Chapter 1. Andhra Pradesh. Did you know Andhra Pradesh is the only state to have three functioning capitals? Amaravati, the legislative capital, Visakhapatnam, the executive capital, and Kurnool, the judicial capital. 1. Andhra State. In 1947, present-day Andhra Pradesh formed the northern part of Madras province, which was British India's largest administrative subdivision in South India. Madras province, Madras State from 1950, was so large that it contained within its boundaries all the major language groups of South India. Linguistically, the northern districts were Telugu dominant, and the southern districts were Tamil dominant, while the city of Madras lay almost on the linguistic border. This was a curious situation, for Telugu was the second largest language spoken in independent India. According to the 1951 census, which combined Hindi, Urdu, and Punjabi into the single largest language, Telugu was spoken by 9.24% of the Indian population, while Tamil was fourth after Marathi, spoken by 7.43% of the population. Rarely does it transpire that a majority faction has to petition for its own space. The demand for a separate Andhra province was articulated first in 1913 with the creation of the Andhra Mahajana Sabha. However, tensions soon cropped up between the two regions within Andhra. Rayalaseema feared that they were unequally placed in relation to coastal Andhra, and that integration would result in greater advantages to coastal Andhra. These fears were allayed when leaders from the two regions came to an agreement in November 1937 to ensure equitable development and representation in both regions. This was known as the Sri Bagh Pact, which also provided for separation of the High Court and the capital city. Pre-independence, the Indian National Congress, INC, had supported the formation of linguistic provinces. In 1927, the INC had opined that Andhra, Utkal, Sindh, and Karnataka could be constituted into separate provinces on the basis of the people speaking the same language and following the same traditions and culture. At its Calcutta session in 1937 and in its 1938 Wardha resolution, the INC had recommended the formation of Andhra and Karnataka and assured to undertake it as soon as they had the power to do so. However, after witnessing partition, the centre wasn't keen to immediately create linguistic provinces. The Linguistic Provinces Commission, popularly known as the Dhar Commission after its chairman S.K. Dhar, was set up in 1948 to explore the feasibility of reorganizing states linguistically. It recommended postponing the matter for a few years. The following year, a JVP committee, named after its members Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, Head of the States Ministry Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, and Congress President Pattabhi Sitaramaya, was set up to study the issue. It cautioned against the disintegrative effects of reorganization. Prime Minister Nehru further stated that the consolidation of India was paramount at the moment, and this would obviously be the wrong time to create linguistic provinces. Potti Sri Ramalu, a 51-year-old former sanitary engineer and railway man, changed the course of events. Seeing much talk but little discernible progress on Andhra, Sri Ramalu began a fast unto death in Madras on 19th October 1952. His fast fast-tracked the demand for statehood by the Telugu population, adding a sense of emotional urgency to the demand. Both language groups claimed the city of Madras as their own, believing they had a more significant demographic and economic presence in the city. The Tamils, however, held the advantage. In November 1949, the Congress...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.